boy or girl, to be revealed later. In the meantime, Danielle Botfield has left her job at a supermarket because she did not feel safe.
I initially told them when I was about 7 or 8 weeks pregnant, and I didn't get a risk assessment for about another 4 to 5 weeks, which is quite a long time considering the job that I was doing was heavy lifting.
Danielle was then moved to the till. Again, this was not risk assessed.
I was worried because, one, I was pregnant, two, I have asthma, and I was having to come into close contact with people, even on the self-scan.
Last week, Channel 4 News revealed that a small number of pregnant women are ending up in intensive care, almost always in their third trimester. Now we have been shown evidence that expectant mothers are not receiving adequate protection when they go to work. The UK government guidance is that all women less than 28 weeks pregnant should be risk assessed, including assessing risks of COVID-19 infection, and that this should be kept under review throughout the pregnancy. At 28 weeks and beyond, all employers should consider both how to redeploy these staff and how to maximise the potential for home working wherever possible.
The risks of COVID-19 to pregnant women are small, and there is a real concern about frightening them unnecessarily. Nevertheless, from 28 weeks on in pregnancy, that risk does rise, especially if they catch COVID-19. They can become severely ill, and there is a heightened risk of premature birth, which makes assessments, those risk assessments from employers, that much more important. But research shows this is not always happening.
Run by the Pregnant Then Screwed campaign, a poll of 7,000 women who have given birth since December or are pregnant found that more than half of those working outside their home don't feel safe at work. 27% hadn't been risk assessed by their employer to check if it was safe for them to work, and 66% of those who couldn't work from home also couldn't socially distance at work. When the campaign asked for more detail, they were swamped with heartfelt emails, including from a number of NHS workers.
I work for the NHS. They told me that working in a red zone, patient-facing, was fine and no adjustments were needed, even though I have other health conditions and my pregnancy's high risk. I begged for risk assessment after risk assessment and was told to get on with it and get over myself.
We would like to see information on exactly what a risk assessment should contain. That information really isn't clear. But we would also like to see the government communicate that information. They've put it on a website. Nobody seems to know it even exists. There's been nobody talking about this in Parliament. There's been no social media campaign about how to keep pregnant women safe.
Women have complained about confusing and inadequate guidelines and about fears of losing their jobs if they say anything.
My boss doesn't believe in COVID. I have to see members of the public in my role. My midwife has advised me against this, and when I've relayed this back to my boss, it's been ignored. After a number of weeks, I received a risk assessment that had no mention of COVID.
And back to the big reveal, Danielle's baby is due in May. But she says her anxiety about her safety is now replaced by worrying about not having a job.
We've just received a statement from the Department of Health and Social Care just now. They say employers are legally obligated to carry out risk assessments for all workers, including pregnant women. And if safety measures cannot be put in place, then pregnant women should be given paid leave. Any employee, they say, who has concerns should raise these through their employers or the Health and Safety Executive, as they can take enforcement action if needed.
Well, Victoria, of concern to pregnant women and all of us, of course, infection rates. What are they doing?
Yes, well, as you heard earlier, there is some good news today from Imperial College's REACT study. They put the R number at 0.72, so below one, with cases halving every fortnight. The highest infection rates were in the north and Yorkshire and the Humber, but in other areas they saw the prevalence fall by around 80%. Again, it fell too across all age groups, but with the highest prevalence among 5 to 12-year-olds, perhaps a reflection that many more are going into primary schools than they were in the first wave, and also amongst 18 to 24-year-olds. Now, one of the authors said it's all very encouraging and it's definitely good news, but hospitals are still under pressure, both from new admissions and people still being treated. The levels, in fact, are the same as they were at the peak of the first wave, and the authors warn, ahead of next Monday's announcement by the government, there is a delicate balance, but we are not out of the woods yet before we start unlocking.
Right, there is news in Northern Ireland as well.
Yes, they are still struggling, and today lockdown restrictions were extended until the 1st of April. There will be a phased reopening of schools from the 8th of March, then a review of lockdown restrictions is to take place on the 18th of March.
There's also been an announcement on long COVID.
Yes, four major studies into the long-term effects of coronavirus, or long COVID, are to take place with £18.5 million of government funding. Now, they're going to look at the cause, symptoms and effects of long COVID, the impact also on children, and why some people develop it and others don't. You know, it is a debilitating condition for some people and is yet another of the many mysteries of this virus.